one for you. I like the way that sounds. I'm about to do it for you. I like to break it down. Bonjour, Meyer Osram. Bonjour, Jacqueline.
Bonjour. Bonjour.
So with this Tuxedo album, it's kind of Back to the Future of the 80s funk. Yes. I'd like to know if all this stuff, like, I don't know, D-Train, One Way, Shalamar, all that, was it stuff that you were listening when you were like little kids, or it's more stuff that you discover through hip-hop samples?
Yeah. It was mostly through hip-hop, yeah, like the 90s West Coast stuff, like G-Funk, so the Dr. Dre, Battle Cat, DJ Quick, Nate Dogg, that kind of stuff. Ooh, is whoa. Really how we discovered, you know, the deeper stuff, you know, out of the genre. And
you were dating the original?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, then we were looking for the original samples or the songs that inspired those songs, you know, and we learned about most of the, you know, obviously we knew like Michael Jackson and Rick James and you know, Chic, Good Times, you know, but we didn't learn about Bernard Wright until way later, exactly. You know, and Sky and, you know, Plush and all that. Like, that, those are obscure records that we didn't learn about until later.
We know that you are no rookies, or you had some stuff before this Tuxedo project, but so what happened from like just exchanging mixtapes between you to a real band and a real album?
I actually, you know, he wasn't singing, first of all.
So
when we first met, he wasn't
Mayer Hawthorne. There was no Mayer Hawthorne yet.
So I kind of just experimented with some tracks that weren't hip-hop tracks. They were more like this. And he ended up doing that song, Just Ain't Gonna Work Out, played that for me. So maybe like a week or so later, I sent him the beat for the first song on the album, Lost Lover, and he sent me a song back the next day. And we kind of just went from there. We just kept working on songs in our spare time. And somehow now we have an album out.
But it was just what, for fun?
It was definitely for fun.
We
didn't start this with like, oh, well, the label's gonna be this and we're gonna have a promo campaign. It was like, no, we just were making songs. And
you were just making songs.
We got to a point where they started feeling really good, you know. And
we had kind of a, you know, I was done with my deal with Universal, and I was kind of in between albums and not touring as much, and Jake had a break from producing for a second, and so we decided it was, you know,
it was time.
It's like it might be the right time.
Yeah.
So from all your previous personal works, what specifically this project, from the way you worked, the way you wrote, from everything?
It was drastically different for me because I never had been in, well, first of all, this is the first thing I've done with no samples. And then also the part of just being in the studio for everything and creating everything together was just a different kind of thing for me. So, you know, beyond it, just, you know, genre change. That was a big part of it, you know, and he's produced his own record, so.
It was really nice for me because I had somebody doing half of the work for a change, you know. I'm doing everything myself, so. Man, it's really nice to have somebody else that's making making some ideas, and then I can just write to right away. It makes it so much faster.
So you worked with John Morales, the almighty John Morales?
Yes,
the mix god,
the legend.
John Morales.
So how does that happen? You called him,
It was a thing where, we tracked him down. We had heard the Eminem mixes. We also were obviously familiar with the classics he's done, but the Eminem mixes to me was like, that's how we wanted our stuff to sound. It was current, but it had the integrity of the old stuff. So I reached out to him through a friend of mine named Khan, who was friends with him. And, you know, eventually he just he decided he wanted to do it, you know, and
he
wasn't aware of who we were.
He had no idea who we were, and like I think it was like one of his
he knew somebody out here that was like, yeah, Tuxedo, like you need to do that.
Who told him that he should do it, and then he finally listened to it, and he was like, oh man, this was actually, you know, my kind of thing. So, yeah, but it was hilarious. I mean I went out to his house in
New Jersey.
And it was just a crazy experience just sitting with him. And you know, he comes from the real disco era.
He was there.
And so he wanted to make a 10-minute extended mix of every song.
Yeah.
And we had to kind of like dial him back, you know. We had to really kind of cut him off and say, no, it has to be 3 minutes for the album, and then you can do
he's gonna do his extended.
We're gonna release some of his extended disco edits though. Of the songs.
I guess for him it was like back in the days, or
I think he got really excited and just like he just started.
Yeah, going. I feel like we had something good when he would email us like, yeah, this song, I want to play this at my gigs. I'm like, like, you know, if you feel good about it, then we feel good about it.
He would call me and he would say, hey man, I just did a DJ gig in Dubai and I played your song, and he wasn't even done mixing it yet. He said, everybody loved it. I'm like, okay, great, awesome. That's a good sign.
How did you work with him? Because you asked him to do some precise stuff and what was it?
We sent him the files, and then Mayor actually went out and sat with him for a couple of days to make sure everything was exactly.
I wanted to be there because we didn't know. We'd never worked with him before, you know. We didn't know
him at all. Yeah.
We wanted a very specific thing too, and we knew exactly what we wanted.
What do you mean by specific thing? In terms of sounds,
we wanted to. It was really important for us to maintain the integrity of the songs. And we wanted it to be authentic, to feel authentic. But at the same time, we wanted it to compete in the club with everything else, you know, with Stromae, you know, or
Katy Perry.
Whoever. Yeah, we wanted, if we played the Tuxedo song after Katy Perry, we wanted it to sound just as big. You know, we were also incorporating a lot of the West Coast rap that that was like, that was our era.
Yeah.
You know, we weren't around for the original disco era. We don't even know what that was like. So, you know, I think just approaching it from our hip hop background just automatically just makes it something new.
This kind of 80s funky, I mean, was not so much hype last years, and suddenly it was like things like Get Lucky, and everybody was listening again to Chic and all that.
Right.
Which was great, you know. I think when we heard those songs, it made us feel like, wow, okay, maybe the world might be ready for this.
The world is ready for
more
Tuxedo
than we thought. And it was also kind of a kick in the butt to get ours finally done, because we've been sitting on it so long.
Shit,
we didn't want to be late to the party.
Maybe it's time to finish this album.
Yeah.
So is it like something would push you to?
Oh yeah,
this is a Daft Punk single, for example.
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah.
Yeah. When I heard it, I was like, oh shit. Like they did it.
Because we were like, man, this is a number one song right now, and we have 20 of these.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. It was a kick in the butt. It was a good one though. And I was really happy to hear songs that I thought sounded good on the radio and hear them everywhere. So that was awesome too.
It's nice.
What Tuxedo is going to be like on stage live?
It's an experience. We have a 7-piece band. So.
It's a big production. Yeah, it's something that we're hoping that we can bring all around the world, but it's expensive. You know, It's like it's either for us. It's either all or nothing.
Yeah.
Mm. You know, because we don't want to do a miniature version of it. It's just not, it wouldn't be as, it just wouldn't be right.
You mean that in a way it was also a project that his direction was to live on stage too, and not just to be a studio thing?
Yeah, yeah, well, you know, I hadn't even considered it until we were about to put the album out.
The album is about dancing.
Yeah.
The whole record is about dancing. And, you know, it's cool to when we get to do these DJ gigs that, you know, we're getting people to dance, but, like, yeah, the real shit is...
It's actually our record.
Doing it live, you know, and just, you know, it's about getting people to move.